Good evening, friends, and welcome to the weekly press briefing. I will begin with an announcement. At the invitation of the Prime Minister of India, the Prime Minister of Nepal, Shri K.P. Sharma Oli, will be visiting India from 19th to 24th February 2016. This would be Prime Minister Oli's first visit abroad after assuming office. Prime Minister Oli will meet our Prime Minister and call on President Pranab Mukherjee on the 20th of February 2016. During the visit, the two sides are expected to hold wide-ranging discussions on issues of mutual concern, as well as on our bilateral cooperation in diverse areas, including developmental assistance, energy, and connectivity. The visit is expected to lead to a further strengthening of our age-old, close, and friendly relations with Nepal. That was the only announcement I had. Floor is now open for questions. Oh, excellent. First time ever, no questions. Okay, Mukesh. Please take the mic.
2-3 weeks ago, you said that in very near future, Foreign Secretary will travel to Pakistan. That are you rescheduling that near future to something else?
The two foreign secretaries remain in touch. If there are any developments, we will let you know. Vinita.
Vikas, can you elaborate on KP Oli's visit? What are the deliverables we are looking at and what are expectations?
No, as you know, when Prime Minister had gone to Nepal, then discussions had taken place on a number of issues, on cooperation in power, in water, in energy, our developmental assistance. As you know, we have given $1 billion worth of reconstruction assistance to Nepal in the wake of the earthquake. So I imagine all these issues will be the subject of discussion, as also the political situation in Nepal, where, as you know now, the agitation by the, at least the blockade on the Birganj-Raksol checkpoint has been now removed, and normal commerce is resuming. So I expect all these issues will figure in the talks that our leadership will have with the Prime Minister Oli. No, I'm sure, as I said, we have a very wide-ranging cooperation with Nepal, which covers diverse areas. So closer to the, as you know, our practice is that closer to the date of the visit, we hold another briefing, and that will be the time when we will give you more details as to what you should expect. Srinjoy.
So you've been hearing what Hedley has had to say over these few days. What is the Indian government going to tell Pakistan about it? I mean, regardless of whether there is a foreign secretary level talks or not, what is the Indian government going to tell Pakistan, and what is it going to ask for?
Well, as you know, David Hedley's testimony is in relation to the Mumbai terrorist attack, and the testimony is self-explanatory. We have always maintained that it is up to Pakistan to investigate and expose fully the conspiracy in Pakistan behind the Mumbai terrorist attack and to bring all concerned to justice. Hedley's deposition once again confirms this view, if any confirmation was needed after Ajmal Kasab's confession. Seema.
How much can we trust Hedley? After all, he's a double agent. Everyone knows that.
Look,
how much weight do we give to his testimony?
As far as we are concerned, this is a testimony, this is a sworn testimony that he is giving, which is admissible in a court of law. And as far as we are concerned, we will go by what he has to say.
The Ministry of External Affairs is hosting the World Cultural Festival along the coast of Yamuna, on which NGT has issued notices.
No, Ministry of External Affairs is not hosting any such festival. Sri Sri Ravi Shankar's foundation is hosting a World Cultural Festival in which a number of international dignitaries are expected to participate. Ashish.
Sir, can you please update us on the fact-finding team which had gone to Bangalore on the Tanzanian woman issue, if you can?
Correct. Well, as you know, based on the directive given by the Honorable External Affairs Minister, a joint team was constituted to travel to Bengaluru. And to the purpose of the team was really to reassure the African community about our commitment to ensuring African students' safety and security, and to facilitate African diplomats having direct interaction on the steps being taken by the state authorities to investigate the matter. The joint team had several briefings, meetings with the concerned state authorities, which included briefing by ADG Police East Bengaluru. They met the Home Minister, along with all concerned officers of Karnataka government. They met with the victim and her friends, and of course, they met with the African students. The following actions were thereafter taken by the state government. 4 constables, 1 inspector, and 1 assistant commissioner of police were suspended. A total of 11 accused persons have been arrested so far. Police patrolling has been enhanced. The state officials have met the victim and her friends and have assured full protection, support, and a fair investigation. As far as the future is concerned, a regular police African students community interaction is being put in place so that future incidents do not occur again. Security for African students has been beefed up and improved. The state authorities, along with college authorities, as well as members of the local community, will be involved in the coordination committees for handling foreign students-related issues. So this tells you that it's called the Police African Students Community Interaction. So this is going to be a regular mechanism now, which will ensure a regular dialogue keeps happening between the student community in the foreign student community in Bengaluru and the local police authorities.
Last night, India and the UAE signed an agreement, I think, about institutional investment into infrastructure. Previously, there had been talk of a $75 billion investment fund for infrastructure. I was just wondering if there is any more detail on the agreement that was signed yesterday. Does that actually contribute to that $75 billion fund? What kind of progress has been made on that fund?
Yeah, I would refer you really to the India-UAE joint statement, which has been issued this afternoon. And that, in a sense, gives you the full picture of the kind of discussions that were held, the kind of agreements that were reached, and the very far-reaching cooperation that has now been put in place with the UAE in a number of, issues. I will read out the portion pertaining to the point that you have just made. The UAE noted its interest in investing in infrastructure development in India, especially in priority areas such as railways, roads, ports, and shipping. The two leaders welcomed the opening of DP World's new smart port, Nav Sheva, in Mumbai on 12th February, and the signing of a framework memorandum of understanding between the UAE and India, which will serve to facilitate and expand the participation of Emirati investors in infrastructure projects in India. The two sides describe these developments as important steps towards reaching the USD $75 billion target for UAE investments in India's infrastructure development plans. And the joint statement also talks about Prime Minister Modi inviting the UAE to participate in India's growth story in projects creating mega industrial manufacturing corridors, including the DMIC, the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, as well as Digital India and Startup India programs. So I would say that, yes, UAE investment in our infrastructure sector is very much on track. Kalol.
So the UAE Deputy Foreign Minister yesterday said that both sides could not reach, or at least will not be reaching, an agreement on the sovereign fund, $800 billion sovereign fund, during this visit, or rather immediately. And he said UAE has communicated to India that India needs to undergo some sort of structural changes before it can access the sovereign fund.
Well, as far as we are concerned, Prime Minister Modi has said this on so many occasions, that India is now the most open country for foreign direct investment. You have seen very well the number of sectors in which we have liberalized foreign direct investment, the number of sectors which have been opened up virtually for 100% investment. So we believe that a very conducive environment exists already for investment by foreign sovereign funds into India's various sectors, whether it is real estate, construction, shipping, infrastructure, whatever you may say. At the same time, we do acknowledge there is always scope for improvement. Yeah. Mike, please.
Pakistan has threatened to opt out of the T20 World Cup if it's not if its games are not scheduled in neutral venues. So would you like to comment on that?
No, I think Mr. Anurag Thakur has already commented. We have nothing to add to that. Venkat.
Because Parvez Musharraf has openly admitted yesterday that the ISI trains the elite and other people and their leader Hafiz Syed is a hero in Pakistan. Would you care to react to this fantastic statement?
Well, I think General Musharraf's admission of ISI involvement in terrorist activities in India speaks for itself, and I think it reinforces once again the need for stopping support to terrorism by state actors in our region. And you know, this is coming from someone who has held the highest office in Pakistan. There at the back.
Sir, ye bahut logon ka khayal hai jo follow kar rahe hain India-Pakistan relations ko ke shuruaat mein jo Pakistan ne concern dikhaya tha, darasal wo anger management tha India ka. Aur jis tarah se haal ke dinon mein ye baat media mein aapne bhi padhi hogi, Pakistani media mein aayi hai ki aapke diye hue sare saboot jo hain wahan kharij kiye ja chuke hain. तो क्या आपका वेट जो है वो एंडलेस है?
नहीं, पहली बात तो ये है कि ये जो आप बात कर रहे हैं कि मीडिया में ऐसे रिपोर्ट्स आई हैं, किसी पाकिस्तानी अधिकारी ने आधिकारिक तौर पर ये कहा है? हम लोग ने तो ऐसा नहीं सुना है. दूसरी बात ये है कि दोनों राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा सलाहकार एक दूसरे से संपर्क में हैं और उनकी जो बातचीत में जो बात आगे निकल रही है उसी के बेसिस पे हम आगे बढ़ेंगे. मनीष
सर, पाकिस्तान हाई कमिश्नर ने अभी कुछ दिन पहले हुर्रियत के कुछ नेताओं से मुलाकात की थी, उसको लेकर अब हमारा क्या स्टैंड है?
देखिए, हमारा जो स्टैंड है कश्मीर को लेकर वो बहुत स्पष्ट है. जम्मू एंड कश्मीर भारत का एक अभिन्न अंग है. यदि पाकिस्तान के साथ इस पर कोई वार्ता होनी है तो वो केवल द्विपक्षीय हो सकती है, उसमें किसी भी थर्ड पार्टी का हस्तक्षेप हम बर्दाश्त नहीं करेंगे.
आपने कहा कि भारत और पाकिस्तान के NSA और FS के बीच बातचीत संपर्क बना हुआ है.
बिल्कुल.
पिछली बार कब दोनों के बीच बातचीत हुई थी? और पठानकोट हमले की जांच के लिए पाकिस्तान ने जो SIT टीम भेजने की पेशकश की थी उसका क्या हुआ?
नहीं, देखिए, पहली बात तो ये, मैं उसका तो ब्यौरा दूंगा नहीं कि इस तारीख को इस समय पे बातचीत हुई है. जैसा कि मैंने कहा है और ये पाकिस्तान की तरफ से भी आ रहा है, उनके अगर आप जो विदेश मंत्रालय के प्रवक्ता हैं उनके अगर आप बयान देखिए तो वो भी यही कह रहे हैं कि दोनों विदेश सचिव, दोनों राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा सलाहकार एक दूसरे के संपर्क में हैं. और अब इसमें और कोई नया डेवलपमेंट होगा तो हम आपको बताएंगे. नहीं, SIT के बारे में जैसा कि मैंने पहले भी मैं कह चुका हूँ कि ये पाकिस्तान की तरफ से एक प्रपोजल आया था, उसके बाद से अब उनको उस प्रपोजल को फर्मअप करना है. यदि वो कहते हैं कि ये SIT आ रही है इस किसी पर्टिकुलर उसके तहत आएगी ना, एक लीगल प्रोसेस के तहत आएगी, तब फिर हम आगे देखेंगे. Sridhar.
So you just said that you're waiting for, you would move ahead on the FS level talks after the NSAs have, tied up things.
No, so I never said that.
No, you said that you would move forward on the basis of the talks between
the
two NSAs.
I said we will move forward on the basis of, the question was asked in the context of the Pathankot terrorist attack, and my answer was in the context. I said that these reports that are coming that Pakistan has rubbished our evidence and all that, as I said, these are media reports. We will go by what is the official channel of communication on this particular subject, which is between the two national security advisors.
So does that in effect mean that you would wait for a go-ahead from the NSA? Before
as
deciding,
I said, we have,
on
I
the
have,
FS level
I have
talks?
Not said that the two foreign secretaries are independently in touch. The two NSAs are independently in touch. If there are any further developments, we will let you know.
Okay.
Yeah. Sachin.
Sir, Pakistan ne abhi Siachen ko demilitarize karne ka ek naya offer diya hai. Uske baare mein kya?
नहीं, सियाचिन जैसा कि आपको पता है जो समग्र वार्ता भारत और पाकिस्तान के बीच में पहले होती थी और जब कॉम्प्रहेंसिव बायलैटरल डायलॉग अगर जब शुरू होगा तो उसका एक हिस्सा है, तो उस वार्ता के अंतर्गत सियाचिन का मुद्दा भी रेस किया जाएगा. दोनों पक्ष उस पर डिस्कशंस करेंगे और जो भी फिर फैसला होगा वो देखा जाएगा. नैनिमा.
Sir, India and UAE signed this MOU on this strategic petroleum reserve.
Correct.
Any details on how much of a strategic reserve they are looking at and
no,
by which
as
deadline?
As I said, now the agreement has been finalized between the company, the special company that has been set up in India for this purpose. So I think it's a pretty important agreement, and I think it really advances significantly our search for the strategic petroleum reserve. No, as I said, it's a matter of that's a matter of detail which we'll have to get from the company concerned. Maybe you'll need to direct your question to the petroleum ministry. Okay, Akhilesh.
Sir, last time when Prime Minister was in UAE, there were very I may say that there was a lot of convergence on the issue of terrorism. Mm-hmm. When Crown Prince came, then we heard not much about this. Even before Ambassador of UAE hold a press conference, which said that we are going to cooperate on ISIS. And Crown Prince also came in the aftermath of Pathankot attack. Correct. And David Headley's affirmation about what Pakistan was doing. So was there these things discussed between UAE and India, because UAE had been a very close friend of Pakistan in the past?
Akhilesh ji, aap apna homework karke nahi aaye hain. Para 33, main padh ke suna deta hu aapko. The two leaders strongly condemned extremism and terrorism in all of their forms and manifestations, irrespective of who the perpetrators are and of their motivations. They reiterated that any justification for terrorism and any link between extremism or terrorism and religion should be strongly rejected by the international community. They reiterated their condemnation for efforts, including by states, to use religion to justify, support, and sponsor terrorism against other countries, or to use terrorism as an instrument of state policy. They further deplored efforts by countries to give religious and sectarian color to political issues and pointed out the responsibility of all states to control the activities of the so-called non-state actors and to cut all support to terrorists operating and perpetrating terrorism from their territories against other states. The two sides deplored the use of double standards in addressing the menace of international terrorism and agreed to strengthen cooperation in combating terrorism both at the bilateral level and within the multilateral system. I don't think you can get any more explicit than that. So, I mean, it's a very, very strong condemnatory statement against terrorism of all forms and against countries which use terrorism as an instrument of state policy. I mean, what more are you expecting? Okay, okay. Mukesh, one more? Kyun? Aise pehle question puchhiye.
Planning joint patrolling in South China Sea, and yesterday China reacted sharply. Would you clear there about this report?
There is no decision like this, and if you look at the U.S. State Department's briefing, they have also clarified that there is no such proposal.
It's not a question of the U.S.
Well, our position on this has been made clear on a number of occasions, that we believe that all such aid actually goes directly into activities directed at India, and it should not be given. Okay, I think with that we have exhausted all the questions. Thank you all.